best thing God ever gave me other than Jesus.
I go tell her. You know what I tell her almost every day? I grab her real tight and I say, this is mine, this is mine, this is mine.
Amen.
That's right. God gave it to me. I'm grateful. To my Reverend Kitty and Brother Kitty. Reverend Hamilton was on her mission today. To Brother Fanny Smith. This brother put Camp Chapel on the map, y'all.
Amen.
Amen. Here at the Indian Conference, and he was featured right in the center of the music ministry. Amen.
Amen.
Now, I know you're not supposed to show out in church, but I don't know what else to call it. He showed out. And we thank the Lord for him. This is the Lucille Canning and the steward boards, to Brother Lee Small and the trustee boards, to Sister and Brother Butler and this powerful music ministry behind us, to our students, our ushers, our AD ministry, and I just want to give one person up. All of them are doing a wonderful job, but you know, Brother Lanier, he takes all these services and puts them on the YouTube, so you don't have to buy a DVD. You can go to YouTube to watch the service. If you miss church, you can watch the service. And then he does a production with it. It's not just a straight thing. He's got all kind of graphics. I just want to lift him up today.
Twin.
Amen.
And Didymus in Greek means twin.
Amen.
They might
been calling him the twin.
Yeah.
Or his parents might have named him the twin. We don't know.
Amen.
Thomas is traditionally given credit for vandalizing India. Some references to Thomas tell us that he was a powerful, miraculous preacher. There are many signs and wonders in his ministry. The Christians of India, even today, call themselves St. Thomas Christians. There are many stories about his death. In Fox's Books of Martyr, it says that he died after exciting the rage of a pagan priest, and he was stabbed through with a spear. Others claim that he died from a stray arrow that might not have been intended for him. I know we got the internet now, and we start doing studies, and if you do any kind of study, you'll find out there are all kinds of ancient books that have Thomas' name on them. Two of the most famous is the Infancy Gospel of Thomas. That's the one where Jesus is portrayed as being this little brat who would make clay pigeons come to life would curse his friends. You see why that one didn't get in the Bible. And the other is called the Gospel of Thomas. Those are two of the more famous works, and that was made famous by Brown. You know, he's the guy that is writing all of this new works with what we call pseudepigraphy. John Gospel spends more time with Thomas than any other gospel. We see Thomas in John 11, Lazarus the sick. And John tells us that Thomas had the nerve to say to Jesus, "We'll go with you to see Lazarus, even if we have to die." And John chapter 14 is Thomas who tells Jesus, "Lord, we don't know where you're going." Now, Jesus just told him where he was going. "Lord, we don't know where you're going, and how can we know the way?" So that makes me think that Thomas was like Peter. One of those impulsive, inquisitive disciples. In our text, Thomas, this church, Jesus had been crucified. The Romans and the Jewish leaders were emboldened and they were willing to persecute the disciples, so the disciples were hiding. For some reason, Thomas must not have gotten the word or didn't think he had to show up, but they had this meeting in this upper room and Thomas doesn't show up. But the Jesus, the glorified Jesus, he shows up, he walks right through the walls. There are locked doors and there appears Jesus. Takes in a deep breath and breathes on the disciples and said, "Receive the Holy Ghost." And they had their first Holy Ghost worship service.
Amen.
Thomas wasn't there. Missed church. Do you share that same experience? Every time we miss church, that's when everything happens.
Amen.
Oh, somebody missed sunrise service and three congregations showed up. There was praise dance, there was worship, there were puppets, there was singing, there was preaching. The Holy Spirit ran high. There was love in the room, but somebody missed sunrise service.
Amen.
That was you, but don't hit it up. Thomas' story is a cautionary tale. It's not that Thomas missed church once. It's a tale about neglecting our spiritual maintenance.
Amen.
80% of our lives should be dedicated to spiritual maintenance. I know this doesn't make you shout, but we need to hear it. Spiritual maintenance. You know, we have to pray constantly, consistently, privately and in a group.
Amen.
We have to study our Bibles privately and in a group.
Amen.
We have to participate in service to God as individuals and in a group.
Amen.
It takes time, dedication, and consistency to keep our spirits in tune.
Amen.
Some of you receive the Campbell Chapel report card. It's just everybody got one?
Yeah.
That's just a list of the things we have to do on a regular basis to keep our spirits in. deterioration.
Amen.
When you get your car taken to the service department on a regular basis and they change the oil and they rotate the tires, they check the brakes and they tap off the fluid, you know your car just lasts longer.
Amen.
Just changing the oil on a regular basis. Well, add tens of thousands of miles to the life of your car.
Yeah.
I saw Brother Jenkins, he gave me the okay there. He knows about that stuff. Tens of that, right?
Yeah.
Just doing that simple maintenance on a regular basis at tens of thousands of miles to your car. People who get up and just pray every morning. At tens of thousands of hours of spirituality to their lives. Just doing that daily maintenance, reading your Bible with your spouse. Carries your marriage to higher levels than it would have been because you're doing that daily maintenance. Now here's the rub. If you miss changing your oil in your car one day, you don't notice it. One oil change doesn't seem to make a whole lot of difference. Didn't rotate your tires this time. Don't notice it. And the truth is, when we miss our spiritual discipline one time, we don't notice it. I don't seem any weaker because I missed some rides. I don't feel any weaker because I didn't go to Bible study. I don't feel any weaker because I didn't have prayer service. My marriage isn't any weaker because we didn't have family altar. But let me tell you something. One time leads to two times, and two times leads to three times. Maintenance allows us to grow beyond our limits.
Amen.
I'm going to 6.2 miles. I came in 11,147 place. I finished 4 hours, 55 minutes, 2 seconds. Now, I'm proud of this. I broke my foot on mile 18. And I hobbled on in, so had I not broken my foot, and in those days they didn't have a little tab in your shoe, it's called wire to wire. When the first person went across the wire, they started the clock. And when you go across the wire, they end the clock. So I spent 30 minutes, I was so far back, I spent 30 minutes just getting to the start line. So I'm happy for my 11,147 players. But let me tell you, 6 months before that happened, I could run 10 miles. Oh, no. I really struggled to run 6. The 6.2 is a 10K, and a 10K would wipe me out. But I'll tell you what I did. I did my homework, I got Runner's World, and I started reading that. I changed my diet. I got my youngest daughter, I don't think you all know her, Tamar. She got on my team, and she would help me, and I do certain things. On Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays, I run what they call strides. On Tuesdays and Thursdays, I ran what they call intervals. And on Saturday, I did my slow, long run. And each Saturday, I ran 1 mile more than I did. And Tamar would come out with water, you know, what like it is now, 96, y'all remember? She'd come rushing out there with the Gatorade. I don't drink Gatorade now, but I did then. And she'd give us water and Gatorade, help me get my long run going. She was big part of me doing it. But what I couldn't do on day one, after consistent maintenance, I could do it 6 months later. What was tough on day one, because I kept doing it, became easier 6 months later. Let me just say something. Some of the things you're praying now, they're almost impossible. You're praying for something to happen in your life right now that just don't seem like it's going to happen. It's over your head. It's just impossible. But keep praying.
Put that away. Do it on a regular basis.
maintenance on our salvation. Listen to what it says. Hebrews 10:25. Let us not neglect our church meetings, as some people do, but encourage and warn each other, especially now that the day is coming back again. The day that he's coming back again is drawing nigh. Proverbs 6:10-11. Get a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to pray. So shall thy party come upon thee as a man that traveleth, and thy want as an armed man. Different translation. A little extra sleep, a little more slumber, a little more folding of our hands to rest. Then poverty will pounce us like a bandit. Scarcity will attack us like a raw man. What is in that? There is a little neglect of our spiritual discipline. Just a little neglect. And one day we wake up and we find we're in a place we didn't want to be. I was teaching the new members course today, and I asked one of the new members about what car that they liked, and they told me, and I said, what if you had that car with all piercing? There's a show called Pimp My Ride. You see that car, we give it to you, it's all pimped out. Got everything in it. Oh, I mean, you got everything. You got the TV, the stereo, everything in that car. You can make coffee in that car. All pimped out, all pimped out. Got your ride there, and you park it in your backyard. And you don't do anything with it for 10 years.
You, and ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied.
Amen.
Glory. All you have to do is stay with him. Keep our hand in his big hand. Walk where he tells us to walk and do what he tells us to do. It's not an excuse to ignore. It's a reason to recommit. And that's what I'm hoping we'll do. We preach a lot of sermons. A lot of sermons. And sometimes we preach so we can celebrate. But today I'm preaching so we can commit.
Amen.
Now we're all committed to the Lord.
Yes.
Let's commit to the disciplines that God's required. Some of us need to commit to the discipline of tithing. Some of us need to join ministry. Or be faithful in the ministry we currently have.
Amen.
Now, there are no officers like this at Campbell, but some officers need to start committing to their office.
Yeah.
And doing the things that their office requires. And some of us just need to commit to have a family altar. Family altar. Oh, I don't want to preach again, but if your family doesn't pray together, why in the world do you expect them to
stay together?
If we can't take a minute and grab hands as a family, I better leave that alone. But God needs us to commit. Commit to the maintenance it takes in our lives. Maintenance isn't exciting, but it has a great reward. Let's all stand to our feet. You want to extend it? Oh, you give the Lord a praise. Sometimes we have to eat our broccoli, right?
Amen.
Broccoli's good for you.
Amen.
Yeah, it's good for you. It may not taste like a whole lot, but it's good for you.
Amen.
So we eat our broccoli this morning. I'm going to open the doors of the church. Perhaps there's someone that doesn't know Jesus and the pardon of his or her sins. We want to give you that opportunity to know the Lord. Maybe there's someone that knows the Lord, but you say, I'm not walking like I used to. My walk is not what it was. The fire is not how it was. We want to give you a chance to recommit, to get back into the maintenance program, to be restored. Or perhaps there's someone that's just looking for a church home. I would recommend to you Campbell Chapel AME Church. Whichever category you may fall in, the doors of the church stand ajar.
Thank you.
We're going to do the abbreviated service. The solicitation and then straight to the prayer of consecration. Solicitation, general confession, and prayer of consecration. You that do truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbor, and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God, and walk from henceforth in his holy ways. Draw nigh with faith and take this holy sacrament to your so I'm going to go change and meet you in the fellowship hall so you don't have to shake my hand before you leave church and do it in the fellowship hall. For those five wonderful people who recited the Ten Commandments, I will see you in the fellowship hall and we're going to give you some encouragement. Campbell Chapel, what color is encouragement? Rest.